Community TV's 2021 Medicine Hat Municipal Election coverage is sponsored by local businesses that support your access to relevant election information. The sponsors do not endorse the candidates or their ideas.
All right. My name is Justin Wright. I am running for city council. I am a father in town here, small business owner, and I am also volunteer within the community.
Creating content like this would be impossible without local sponsors like Animal World. Head over there and see Rob at Animal World on Dunmore Road. Get some pet food. Lucky's Grit Dip. I just tried the new Buffalo Ranch and I love it. McBride's Bakery, home of the Big Elvis Donut. Maxwell Network Realty, supporting growth in Medicine Hat.
What makes you feel like a part of the community?
Medicine Hat has always been one of those communities where I've gone away from work, but anytime I've had the opportunity to come back and always resettle, it's always been Medicine Hat. There are so many unique advantages that Medicine Hat has, from things like publicly owned utilities and even some of the cheaper utility rates compared to other places in the province. It's really been one of those things that, from a point of really building and settling down, has always been that go-to spot for myself.
What is your religion? Do deities play any role in your decision making?
I do attend church here in town. I do attend a Christian church. I believe that everybody should be treated fairly, and you know, in the Bible it does say to love one another like you love yourself, and that's how I try to just live things. So.
And does if you have a tough decision to make, what are the tools that you make to make tough decisions?
I think really it boils down to getting as much feedback as you possibly can from all stakeholders involved in the decision. It's one thing to always have your anticipated response, but if you don't stop, pause, and reflect on how it impacts others out there, you can get into a situation where it seems like there is either no transparency or no form of really getting feedback from the community. And I think that that's where a lot of leaders tend to step into that puddle, if you will, that kind of tarnishes the decision-making process. So trying to get as many stakeholders involved, but still being timely on the process, I think is very important.
What's the worst decision the city's made in the past 5 years?
I think it really boils down to just the long-term strategy in regards to revenue and finances. The city has gone, and you know, even if we put COVID aside, I just take a look at the balance of the budget. We've added an astronomical amount of money in the last 5 years. A lot of it due to downturn in betting big on natural resources. The challenge becomes it doesn't present itself well within the direction of council, as well as the direction of previous councils, to really change the course. You know, we've held that line and this is the way we're going to do it. And I think that that's really tarnished some of the decision-making process, and also the trust in the council to do the right thing for the community, not just, you know, a handful of people.
What do you think of Medicine Hat's skateboarding bylaw?
So I think the skateboarding bylaw might be a little outdated. I understand that there is a lot of, you know, safety concerns when it comes to tight walkways downtown. You've got poles in the way with light standards, things like that. I think that there is some very valid safety concerns. That being said and done, I think it's very outdated and it needs to be reviewed. I know the Medicine Hat Skateboard Association does a ton of good work in the community, from volunteering, fundraising. They go out and do outreach, water wells and things like that. I know that the community as a whole is a very healthy community. Is there safety concerns? Absolutely. Do they all need to be reviewed? Yes. Does it need to be updated? I think so.
This one's kind of like a cheeky question. How do you think you join the old boys club, quote unquote?
Well, if we're referring to like the old boys club as being council, I think by and large, I feel that you have to put the community first.
I think the old boys club, I'm going to qualify it a little more. It's like anytime I've covered a story where it seems to be there's something sneaky going on, they always refer to the old boys club as it's like the, I don't know, some secret organization that runs the show or something like that. So the cheekiness of the question is sort of like, what do you think of that perception?
I think that perception is going to be found anywhere with leadership, especially if there's rushed decision making, or, you know, a downplay of concerns. So ultimately, I don't know if it's as much joining the club as much as it is maintaining the integrity to listen to the community and put their concerns forward. This is a voted position. This has got to be community focused. So I guess from that perspective, you know, if the community chooses me into that club, sure, great. But I think it's about moving forward from that position with integrity and putting the right step forward for the community and always putting their concerns first.
What's the local solution for the mental health crisis that's affecting our community?
This is something that is very near and dear to my heart. A little over 18 months, 2 years ago, my aunt actually passed away from suicide. With this, it has been on my heart for quite some time. I started a small little support group known as the See Tomorrow Project. We have about 125 members. All it is, like, I'm not a psychiatrist or even anybody with a psychology degree. I'm just somebody that points people in the right direction for help. I think there is a ton of really good resources that are available in the community. The challenge is getting people connected to those. I think one option that we could take a look at and very much explore is a local temporary 3-digit number that would basically call forward to the crisis line. The crisis line right now is a 10-digit code. If you're in that state of mind, you're not going to remember 10 digits, but you might remember 911. You might remember 642. I'm just throwing, you know, numbers out there. 211's got a lot of great resources that people can reach out to, but if you're in the heat of that moment, it might not be the right course of action. So exploring and working with the telecom partners that the city works with and setting up, a temporary 3-digit code just to kind of fill the gap between today or October 18th and when it is supposed to launch in, I believe it's March 22nd, 2020, for the national 3-digit number, I think is something that we could easily fill the gaps. And it would both be a positive increase for the community and also very cost-effective. And cost-effective from the perspective of a phone number call forwarded to already existing resources. We're not reinventing the wheel, we're supporting what's there, and we can get the word out of the great programs that are available.
Community TV's election coverage would not be possible without the generous sponsorship of businesses like Gravity Sports. Ben helped me build this tall bike that you might see me riding around every once in a while, and the staff down there know just about everything you could want to know about repairing your bicycle, so bring it down there if you need some help. And of course, Gold Dust Jewelry. Johan and I have been friends for quite a while, and while he's moved out of the retail business, he's still doing custom jewelry out of his home studio. And if you need to get a hold of him, just contact his Facebook page or send him an email, and he'll be able to make you a custom piece of jewelry, just about anything you can imagine, and probably deliver it right to your house. Also want to thank Truckers. 24/7 business on the highway that just about everybody has known for the last 20, 30 years. It's been around longer than I've been around. Truckers Restaurant, it's a great place to stop and have a meal anytime you need one, and it's just like a home-cooked meal. Really special. The staff there are great, and they've always got a cool dessert to try. Sponsoring Community TV's content is a cost-effective return on investment for your business and a great way to show that you care about the community. So if you'd like to get your logo here, please contact me. My email is tom@comtv.ca.
What should the city be doing about truth and reconciliation?
I think the biggest thing that they need to do is just listen. For any of us to assume an outcome or to assume a response with having no direct influence on that would be something that would be wildly inappropriate. The biggest thing to do is just listen, hear the concerns, and we can move forward together. But if we don't come up with a bipartisan kind of motion forward, it's still going to have that constant feeling of hurt and just that pain that kind of comes with still nobody's listening. So,
when it comes to like land rights stuff, like if you're elected, would you be somebody that would be looking for, who came from here and who lived here? I want to talk about them before I start speaking here. Like when people do the land announcements before speeches, is that something you'd be interested in?
I think it would be a matter of really partnering with all the stakeholders first. To sit here as an unelected individual with, no political background or, assessment of the city, I think it would be wildly inappropriate to say this is what's going to happen. I think from a leadership perspective, it's important to listen. I think it's important to reach out and make those connections so that we can move forward without it being something like they're just saying it because, right? We want it to be honest. We want it to be really truthful in the way that we move forward. That's how hurts get healed.
With recent overdoses in our community, what are your thoughts on supervised consumption sites?
I think there is a lot to still be investigated in regards to the consumption sites. There is some incredible pros to them, but there's also some incredible cons with them as well. And, you know, we can't just say it's as simple as, well, the pros outweigh the cons or the cons outweigh the pros. There is so much that goes into this. And even from a mental health standpoint, if we look at the Center for Addiction and Mental Health out of Toronto, they even have a startling stat that 55% of Canadians before the age of 40 will suffer from some form of mental illness. And that's a big number. And to say, well, you know, consumption sites or mental health, suicides, you know, it's one or the other. No, these are all things that intertwine with one another. And we have to do our investigation thoroughly and with an unbiased opinion. Because when we go in with those preformed opinions, that's where we can start to leave people behind, or more and more people can fall through the cracks. So I think investigating with the stakeholders and on both sides of it, we can really bring forward a situation where we can have a site that makes sense for all parties involved. Or we don't. It just, we have to investigate further. I think we're both rushing too much and asking the wrong questions.
Oh, the rent keeps going up, but we've also eliminated chronic homelessness, and I want to know what you think homelessness is.
Well, I firmly believe that homelessness is anybody that is unable to maintain a permanent residence. If you're couch surfing, you're homeless. If you're living in Battis Park, you're homeless. I think the city has done good strides to help eliminate homelessness. And I know it's a very bold, you know, claim that we've eliminated it, but I firmly believe there is much work to be done. We'll wait for that to go by. Yeah.
Awesome.
Okay. I think there's much work still to be done. If you talk to folks in the community, a lot of folks are still very uncomfortable coming down to downtown area. Even some of the North Railway Flats areas around the Mustard Seed. I think there is some really key steps that we have taken, but we need to continue to push in. We have not, by any stretch of the means, eliminated it. We've put a really good Band-Aid. We've put a good tourniquet on it, but we need to get it addressed further. And I think that that is got to be one of the key priorities for the future council, to build that confidence in the community, especially with things like the waterfront district that they've invested $20 million in. It needs to be something where families feel safe coming down and using that space. And I know a lot of them don't as it is.
What's a top issue we haven't discussed yet? And with that issue, do you feel like you've got a plan or a solution?
For sure. I believe we need to continue to build upon Medicine Hat's innate uniqueness. Things like our utility rates. Yes, they're very high right now, and yes, we're all getting a rebate 10 weeks before an election, but hey, who's counting the days? When we look at these are the things that set us apart from anywhere else. These should be the reasons why people are busting down the doors to get into Medicine Hat. I think we've both done a disservice to these services by kind of just continuing to inch up with the market. Yes, there is some of those cost differentials that we have to account for, but I think we've kind of squandered some of the past profits and resources that have come with that, and it's really setting future generations up for failure. Even ourselves, we could see it in our lifetime where it's no longer feasible for that public utility. I think that if you look at the parks, you look at everything around, there is so many key things that should be attracting people to live here, and we need to really start taking care of them. We also need to be attracting good key industry to drive that middle class, but also to drive the folks that are kind of on that bubble out of that bubble. When we do things like that, you will see things like rent begin to become a non-issue, or it should become a non-issue. Things like homelessness, we can begin to address that even to the next step. It begins to close the gaps all the way around. There is a stat that came out in regards to people's identities being taken up in their professions. So as a individual, I have a good job, I feel good about myself. That drives our own self-image up, which then affects our mental health. There's so many key principles that we need to look at to drive those pieces that make medicine attractive. At one point in time, we had some of the most fantastic middle income groups. But as industry's kind of gone away, specifically with oil and gas, that gap has begun to grow. And I think if we look at it as something where it's not just one piece, you know, the thing about a community is you can't just fix one piece and it'll fix everything. Everything needs to come together, and we need to tighten the straps up in order for us to really push forward on those great advantages, like the utilities, like the parks, like the pass that we've got, but also be able to drive that industry and to keep those folks here, to make sure that we can continue to drive up those folks that call Medicine Hat home and help us build forward.
Well, so this one's all about me. What do you think of me and community TV and what I do? And I guess we can go pretty far back, because you and I worked together at what is now Best Buy but was Future Shop for 2 years, right?
Something like that. Yeah,
it was the Apple guy for a while, and then you convinced me to come on board. But tell me what you think of me.
Yeah, you know what? The great thing about any form of media is it gives perspective. It's one of those things, you could go to one source for your perspective, or you can reach out. I do appreciate that you always kind of look at opposite sides to where, you know, everybody tends to be looking. So anytime that you can get somebody to ask the questions that aren't being asked is a great resource to the community. So yeah, that's what I would say on that. So I appreciate it.
Thanks so much.
No worries.
Thanks for hanging out.
No worries. Thanks, Brennan.
Thanks again for watching my Community TV 2021 Medicine Hat Municipal Election coverage. And more of the sponsors of Community TV include Hemptown Rock in downtown Medicine Hat, and Patty's doing big things there. So go see her on Railway in downtown Medicine Hat if you need some glassware, if you know what I mean. And then, of course, if you have ever been accused of something, you need the best defense, and the best defense in Medicine Hat is Yarshenko and Heidinger Law Office. Call my buddy Lyndon Heidinger over there and ask him how he can best defend you. There are plenty more spaces for sponsorships on Community TV, so if you want to see your ad somewhere in this municipal election coverage, just contact me, Tom@comtv.ca. Thanks again for watching.